just, you know, take you very briefly back to the genesis of the film. I mean, was there a point when you thought this?
It's a very biblical way of looking at this.
Was there a moment you thought that we can make a comedy out of this subject matter?
Well, the moment I read about five Yemeni jihadis who wanted to blow up an American warship on Millennium Eve, and they piled down to the harbour in the middle of the night. There was the warship moored offshore, and they put their launch into the water. They filled it with explosives, and it sank. And they... Then the story stopped, and I just thought, you've got five guys standing around a sinking boat. Yeah. Who's going to speak, and what are they going to say? And then you think, oh, hang on, that's like writing a comedy scene. That's a comedy scene. And then that wasn't the only example. There were lots. Mm. The guys who planned the 9/11 attacks and survived it, obviously, because they didn't go through with the operation themselves, were interviewed shortly before they were arrested. And they behaved in a way that was ridiculous, more like David Brent than a mastermind of terror. So there were things that gave clues that this could actually produce a good comedy. And when you're working with people whose expertise, Sam and Jesse, whose expertise is in exploiting the ridiculousness of male characters in particular, you know you're onto a winner.
For example, in your research, I mean, you did 2 years of research in this movie.
Seven.
Yeah. 7 years?
I don't know, it keeps changing. Yeah. I don't know. But it started with Mark.
The official line.
Yeah, no, yeah. 2006. Yeah, when we met in Sheffield, and we just drove around Sheffield, really, and I was just saying to Mark, look, I've got this idea of doing this thing. And that, by then, the idea had already been running around my head for a while, but I hadn't got round to doing anything on it. So that was the first physical step, really. I've been doing a lot of reading and all that kind of stuff. It did take a long time. But you kind of research and write and even do some of the casting at the same time, so it all overlaps.
Absolutely. And bring it all together into the film, all that research, all that reading. It must have been daunting. Was there a time when you thought, I can't do this? This can't fit into a 100-minute film with likeable characters and arcs and...
Yeah, no, most of it's not in the film. Honestly, I mean, intuitively, at some level it is.
Yeah.
I hope. But the film bears an imprint, not a direct sourcing of all that kind of material. But, you know, it would be dreadful if it was all in. You have to make some sort of reduction and do something that seems to make sense in a kind of reflective way rather than a literally incorporating everything. I could go on doing this for the rest of my life with all that stuff.
Absolutely. Obviously, one of the things about the film I really, really admired was the fact that it humanizes these guys. And most films set out to demonize characters like these. So was that something that you wanted to do from the off?
I didn't really think about it that way. I just thought it's an accidental byproduct of being able to see people as ridiculous, because being idiotic, which we all are at times, is quite a levelling thing to do. So it's a byproduct of that. But I don't think it's a bad thing either.
I just wanted to talk about the five guys who play the four lions. Fantastic chemistry between them. And was that something that just came naturally?
No, it's because Mark locked them in. Mark locked them in. Actually, Darren locked them in an apartment, in a just-built apartment in Sheffield, and just sort of locked them on a floor and let them get on with it. I mean, they all lived there, and they did develop a sort of alternative kind of a mirror version of their characters on screen. Because they were just, you know, stuck in there with each other. So it was a kind of cross between a friendship and deep enmity that broke out between them. I think they did form a close bond, because we were all basically just really on it the whole time. There wasn't much room to break out and develop anything in the real world. So it all was kind of enclosed, brainwashing, forming a cell type operation. And they were, I mean, they rose to it. They were, you know, and I said it tonight, but they were just brilliant. They were brilliant. All the offcuts, all the stuff, the tons of stuff on the cutting room floor, they're all brilliant. None of it's there because they didn't get it. They didn't put a foot wrong.
Yeah, absolutely. I think in the very first blog that we did on the film from Sundance, Damon compared the film to an alien comedy. Was that the vibe you were going for, in a way?
Well, there was one moment where we were having a meeting, Sam, Jesse and I, and Sam went, I just sort of, you know, roughed out the scene where they're pretending to be a band. He said, my favourite film is The Lady Killers. I'm so glad you've written in a reference to The Lady Killers. And I was thinking... Yep, I could right now. I could pass that off as if that was a conscious thing to do. So, cut that as you will. And it's not deliberately an alien comedy, but possibly bears the imprint of having read Sandy McKendrick's book not too long before I embarked on it, which I mean, he directed some Ealing comedies, and I think it's more... Actually, you know what? There's more... It's things like Blimp. So not Ealing comedy, but a film which takes a character, ridicules a character, shows a character falling out of time, but yet maintains an understanding for that character that it's ridiculing. Yeah. That gives you a clue. And that just seems a much more interesting treatment of a character than just sort of going, that person's a twat for that reason, bam, they're a twat, they're a Burke, and just pointing at them and chucking them out the window. You know, you stick with them and then see it from more angles. Yeah.